Gentlemen, welcome back.
Hello, everyone. If I could ask you to take your seats, please, so we can get on with the program. Thank you. Thank you for taking your seats. Okay. Couple more seconds. Okay. Well, I hope you all enjoyed your break, albeit it was a mini break. So now I'm starting to feel badly. Now I feel like I gave you gift bags, but I'm not Oprah, so I didn't give you a car. I didn't get you a vacation, and I gave you a mini break. So I say sorry in advance. But there will be a really good lunch. I continue to hype up this lunch. It had better be fabulous. Let's dive straight back into the action. Because, listen, I don't know many times in life that you get to spend 90 minutes in the company of such great minds. If you have, please let us know, because I want to hang out with you. Seriously, this is going to be really, really amazing, a great conversation. And to kick things off, can you please give a warm welcome back to Melinda Gates?
So I'm really delighted to invite the next leader to the stage. He's a person who's known worldwide for his passionate belief in empowering women. He's insisted on having a 50% female cabinet. He's committed, yeah. He's committed to allocating 95% of Canada's foreign aid towards gender equality. And he said that he won't stop fighting for this cause until when someone asks him if he's a feminist, all he'll have to do is shrug. So please join me in welcoming to the stage Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. Mwah. Always love being with you. So it's great that we get this chance to talk, and you and I have spent some time together over the past because I think we have very similar agendas. Your government's foreign aid, our foundation on things like agriculture and nutrition and lifting people up. And I want to talk, though, today about gender equality. How did you come to this decision that you wanted to support gender equality, and specifically that you wanted to have a cabinet that was 50% women? Because that's been transformative.
Well, it was simply understanding, I mean, one of the core pieces of Canada's success in general is that we get the diversity as a source of strength. Having different perspectives, different backgrounds, different origins, different people come together to share the same challenges and find solutions for them has always been a great creative driver, a great driver of solutions. And one of the most obvious diversity plays you have to make is that you have equal representation of men and women. And we had a provincial government a number of years before that had done a 50-50 cabinet in Canada, and I said, well, let's make sure that we do. And you know, I think some of you may remember that I said, you know, why do you do it? Well, because it's 2015. But before it could be 2015, it had to be 2014, 2013, 2012, where I and my team went out and recruited all sorts of great women candidates to run for politics, to convince them to step up so that we could then choose this extraordinary merit-based but diverse cabinet we had.
And was it hard to get women to say, I want to enter politics? Is it different than getting a man to want to enter politics?
When you ask a man if he wants to run for politics, his first question is usually, what took you so long? when you ask a woman, her first question is, really, why me? Or do you think I'm qualified? Or do you really think I should? Or do you think I have a chance? It typically takes more conversations to try and get over that hump. And then it takes a thoughtful level of, okay, there's going to be a little more challenges on organization maybe, or more challenges on fundraising, and how we actually develop the tools to have that parity is really important. So we're pleased to be sort of modeling that it can be done. But we're also pleased to be pointing out that it leads to great and better decision making. And that's where we're seeing more and more corporate boards and more industries and institutions saying, no, we're going to go for parity, not because it's just the right thing to do, but because it's a smart thing to do.
And tell me about informing your cabinet. How do you think the conversations, I know you haven't run the other one, would you, thank goodness that we've had an all-male cabinet, but how do you think the conversations are different by having women at the table?
Oh, I can tell you. I remember the story of a government in the early 60s where there was a question of, oh, yes, no, this woman really should be in cabinet. And the answer was, no. We already have a woman in cabinet. We don't need a second. And I think one of the things you have when you have a panel with only one woman on it or a board of directors with only one woman on it is that woman then has to speak for all women. And what we have now is we have women who speak for their own perspectives, their own experiences that are sufficiently diverse and sufficiently wide-ranging that you do get a fuller perspective on that. And that's something that was a challenge to set up, but it's also a challenge to keep. I mean, we went out and recruited a lot of great young women to run for politics, and they did, and they were successful. And now we're having a bit of a challenge, not a huge challenge, but a bit of a challenge around retention. As people are realizing that, wow, this is a really nasty place to work. There's a lot of things that, parliaments are built for elderly white grandpas, right? That's the way things historically went. And to have young women one of our ministers has just announced that she's pregnant. She's going to have a baby in March, which we're really excited about, but it's bringing a whole new and important level of conversations about how we make sure that we're enabling her to continue to do her job and to do her job, but to be a great mom at the same time. And those are way overdue, and we wouldn't be having them if we hadn't pushed the envelope on the dynamic.
You're also role modeling. I mean, you're role modeling not just for other Canadian citizens and for other young girls that they could be part of government or part of a corporate board. You're really role modeling for the world. And do you think about that a little bit in the back of your mind? And what, I mean, you grew up and you certainly had role models you looked up to in politics, I would assume. And so how do you think about that role modeling and how important it is or isn't?
It obviously is something important. If I can challenge people to not just see, oh, this is what you want to do if you want to get invited onto panels like this. It's what you want to do if you want to be successful. It's what you want to do if you truly want to create growth that works for everyone and include everyone in the economic opportunities we have. But that, I mean, I grew up with role models. My dad was an amazing role model in his fight for rights. You couldn't call him a feminist, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I remember from university when I was involved in the McGill Debating Union and then got involved in the Sexual Assault Center as one of the few male facilitators in their outreach program. I remember having arguments with a colleague of mine who was also a debater about whether a man could be a feminist. And I said, well, I think I can. I think I am. And she said, no, only women can be feminists. You can be supportive or you can be an ally, but it's our thing. And I, that 20, 25 years ago, that was certainly a stronger perspective, but still people have it. And there's a lot of room to have discussions around this. And for me, even with where I was comfortable with the idea of being a feminist, I didn't actually come out and openly say that I was a feminist until, and I actually haven't ever told this story before, I saw a video in 2014 of Joseph Gordon-Levitt looking at the camera and saying, yeah, I'm a feminist. I think men can be feminists, it's important. Wow. And it wasn't that, oh, I'm gonna follow his lead. It was like, oh, okay. It's okay for men to say that they're feminists in a public sense. Great, I'm going to finally do that. And I think it's important that we all remember that if there is an imbalance, which there is, of men having more strength and more weight to their words in an unfair way, then men have to be part of the solution in using that weight and strength that they were unfairly given to realign the balance. And that's why I will keep saying I'm a feminist until, as you say, it's met with, yeah, we know that, move on, that's not a big deal anymore. You know?
You know, I think it's great that you're not only role modeling it for men, you are also role modeling it, though, for women. Because I know the first time I was asked about whether I was a feminist, I was 29, and I had to really stop and think about it. And I wasn't quite ready to take on that moniker. And we hear that from young women today. And yet when they start to lean into it and see the positive aspects of it, they do decide, hey, I am a feminist. I am for all women around the world, if that's what it means.
Yeah, and there's so many academic differences and definitions and the waves and this and that. I try not to get too bogged down in that, although some people are happy in there. I just think that there is a reclaiming of that word in a good way that is not exclusive, is not about bashing the other sex. It's about saying, no, we stand for equality, and we know there's a lot of work still to do. If you believe those two things, then you get to be a feminist. Mm-hmm. And that's the approach that I'll take on it. And quite frankly, I think one of the things we're seeing, and I was talking about this a few weeks ago with someone who was telling me about their daughter who didn't see the need to define themselves as a feminist, they didn't want to, and then the current political context in the United States has had them decide to step up and be more vocal and realize, oh, we can't take things for granted and we need to continue to fight for rights, and I think that's a great thing.
You've been, besides being, I'll say, an active feminist, a vocal feminist, you've also been involved in youth movements long before you came into this role. Tell us about what you saw in the power of those youth movements and why you decided to get involved in those.
Young people, in general, would get a bad rap for being disconnected and apathetic and disengaged. And that's sort of the reputation they had because they didn't get involved in politics all that much. But if you actually have a conversation with young people, you realize that yes, there can be cynicism and apathy and disconnectedness, but it didn't come from not caring about the world. It often came from caring so much and being frustrated that they weren't given the opportunity or the tools to weigh in. So I was involved for many years, actually before getting into politics, and it's part of what drew me into politics in National Youth Service program in Canada, where we took young people and gave them the tools to discover that they can shape through volunteer service communities right across the country and develop and learn and grow and discover that they can have a tangible impact, not as leaders tomorrow when eventually they become successful in the world and get through a career, but leaders immediately with the choices they make, with the energy they have, with what they do. So reflecting on the fact that young people want to be involved but never really thought of politics as a useful way of making much change at all, we decided to turn that around and show that politics could be a very powerful driver of positive impact on the things that young people care about, whether it's diversity or the environment or progressive growth, those kinds of things, that giving everyone a fair chance, or technology and net neutrality and those kinds of things. When you reach out to young people about the things they care about and you give them a voice and you give them weight to that voice, you get great things.
Well, and part of what we're trying to do today with Goalkeepers is really to have young people understand what amazing leaders they can be in the world, and that if we're going to accomplish these goals that the United Nations and you were part of setting out for 2030, we need them to use their voice and their platforms. Just bringing these two ideas together of youth movements and women, you've also been supporters of women's movements. Tell me how you came to that decision for yourself.
Well, more specifically, in the choices we make as a government around development aid, we move forward with a feminist international assistance policy that recognizes that the best way to affect real change in struggling or developing communities is to empower women. Mm-hmm. And that means, as you said, that 95% of our development aid in the coming years will be on gender equality or women's supportive programs. But more specifically, a conversation I had with someone who I think was here today, Lima Bowie, talking about how empowering grassroots women's organizations in developing world communities is the best lever to having real transformative impact. I think we all know that there's been billions, trillions of dollars over the past decades flown in foreign aid that gets ending up in, you know, big organizations or trickled down through various governments that are not always as transparent and rigorous as we'd like with the aid dollars. And realizing that we can't just keep throwing money at things the same way, but we really need to figure out how to make the biggest difference, to stretch our aid dollars as far as possible. Putting it in the hands of local grassroots women's organizations is the most powerful way to do it. And that's why Canada just recently announced, as part of our Feminist International Development Policy, a $150 million investment in grassroots women organizations.
Amazing. Which is really incredible. So while Lima was here on stage earlier this morning, she also challenged us as a foundation.
Because she challenged us to do exactly that, and we did. It was directly from her.
She's a very powerful voice and advocate. And I think what she said was so powerful, just what you said, which it is, they know their community. They know what needs to get done. So with the foundation, what Bill and I have decided to do is that an $80 million commitment we made last year to women and girls, we're going to put $20 million of that now behind women's grassroots movements.
Bravo. So,
you've been around the world, you've been around amazing leaders, you've been around youth, you've been in local communities. What do you want this group to know when you look out as a global leader at 2030? What do you want them to think about or know is possible?
I think everything is possible. I mean, the drive, the awareness, the hopefulness, the positivity, the optimism, the confidence we see out there, even with the challenges, the anxiety, the worries, the setbacks we have, I feel incredibly optimistic about the future because I have spent so much time talking to young people, activists, citizens who are aware that we have so many more levers to impact change in the world now than we ever have before. And I think that's really sort of the core issue for me is, I mean, so much of politics and so much of advertising consists of dumbing down the message. You play for the anger of the left, or you play on the fear of the right, and you simplify to the smallest soundbite some emotional way to get people to vote or to purchase or to participate. And instead, if you actually have thoughtful conversations about the difficult challenges we're facing, if you appeal to voters' reasonableness and intelligence, if you reach out to citizens as thoughtful agents of change within their neighborhood, within their community, that is where we actually shift the world. People are getting much more information, much more education about what the world's going on. We have to respect them to do right with that knowledge and that education and start treating citizens like reasonable, thoughtful adults is going to transform the way our politics and therefore our world works.
Well, I want to say, yeah. I want to say on behalf of everyone in this room and behalf of Goalkeepers and Bill and myself, thank you for your thoughtfulness with which you help role model and teach in the world and your leadership on the world stage and with youth and women. Thank you so much.
Thank you. But also, let me just say this. The leadership that Bill and Melinda and Goalkeepers and in general, people stepping up from non-governmental positions to help drive this conversation is something that makes the work we all have to do immeasurably easier. So thank you so much for your leadership.
We love the partnership.
Well, thanks to Melinda for that and Prime Minister Trudeau. Can I just say, now that I've met him, albeit briefly, I totally understand why so many of my friends are talking about relocating to Canada. Totally get it. I may even have to add my name to the list. Maybe he'll fast track my paperwork. Big thanks to him and for all that he's doing in keeping women front and center. In a few minutes, Bill Gates is going to take over the stage. But before that, I know, can we, a little bit more excitement. But before that, another illustration of how change can and is happening, and how taking the goals seriously, taking the promises seriously, leads to real progress. While illness is universal, sadly, access to healthcare is not. There are a billion people in the world who aren't within reach of a trained health professional. In developing countries, we're talking about 8.9 million people, and about that, we're talking about 3.6 million children included in that number. And this number die each year because they don't have the necessary maternal, neonatal, child health services. But there are organizations who are taking this on. They are taking it head on. One of them is Last Mile Health, who train community healthcare workers in vital medical skills so that they can go the extra mile and help people in even the remotest of areas. I want to show you a short film now, just to show you how healthcare in Liberia has been revolutionized thanks to community health workers. Take a look.
Liberia suffered 15 years ago. We have one of the worst doctor shortages in the world. If you're a two-year-old and you come down with a fever, your mom would have to put you on her back, get to the riverbed, get in a canoe, paddle across to the other side, and walk sometimes for up to 2 days just to get a diagnosis at a clinic. The tyranny of distance is what we talk about, that if you're too far away, you're the last to receive health services, but you're the one that often needs it the most. Our vision at Last Mile Health is to deploy a health worker for everyone, everywhere, every day. And we work with governments to take those networks of community health professionals and scale that nationally. The training that these folks receive covers everything from tracking the next Ebola, the next disease outbreak, to treating children for malaria, diarrhea, pneumonia, and malnutrition. That worker then is equipped with a backpack full of the medicines and the gloves and the treatments and the diagnostic equipment. We're starting with Liberia because we think that if we are able to show that it's possible to deliver a model for remote healthcare delivery that isn't conservative but radical, that goes further than it's ever gone before, that lifts the standard of care for people in the most remote communities, we think that will generate momentum to help us get to the second and the third country. It's been true for all of human history that illness is universal and access to care is not. That doesn't have to be true in this century, and we have a chance to change that.
Such important work. It really is. I'd like to welcome to the stage Raj Punjabi, founder of Last Mile Health, to share his plans to create a global army of community health workers. Please welcome him.
Thank you, Aisha. I just got back a few weeks ago from caring for patients with some of these community health workers, and it was inspiring to see that in a place deep in the heart of the forest where the Ebola epidemic had nearly brought us to our knees, these community health workers who had gone door to door to find the sick, get them into care, break the chain of transmission, and help stop this virus, are now providing care to the children and families you just saw in that film, and that the Liberian government is investing to scale this nationally so that every child and family in our country have access to care. Other governments are trying to do this as well. In Ethiopia, I want to thank the Bill and Melinda Gates and the Foundation for what they're doing to push community health systems forward across the world. And we know this is important. We cannot achieve the global goals without investing in hiring, training, and equipping community health workers. In fact, we know that if we were to train a global army of community health workers to perform even 30 medical services, we could collectively save 30 million lives by 2030. But we simply can't do that without technology. We know that it's time. It's time for a collision between the community health worker revolution and the digital education revolution. And that's why we're creating, with partners here, the Community Health Academy, to reinvent the education of community health workers and the leaders who support them for the digital age. I'm thrilled to announce today that a coalition of over 15 partners, the public, private, and nonprofit sectors, is launching the first phase of the Community Health Academy. We're starting with a free, open, online continuing education platform and courses that will be provided for policymakers, managers, and nonprofit organizations who are looking to build strong national community health systems like Ethiopia's and Liberia's. We'll be launching our first online course this year, and it will be taught by leading community health innovators from Africa, Asia, and Latin America. Further down the line, we plan to create mobile apps that will enable community health workers to receive the very best in digital education resources, like video lessons on promoting family planning and a podcast on how to spot the next outbreak. And we'll work with partner countries to help ensure that community health workers don't remain an informal, under-recognized, undervalued group, but become a renowned, empowered profession like nurses and doctors. We're deeply grateful to the partners, and many of whom are here today, that are teaming up on this project. And I want to end by saying that our collective dream is for this academy to help contribute to the training of hundreds of thousands of community health workers, from the forest communities of West Africa to the fishing villages of Alaska, from the plains of rural India to the mountaintops of Afghanistan. And if this aligns with your vision, we hope you'll join us in this effort. Illness is universal, access to care is not. But as we say where I come from in West Africa, no condition is permanent. It's time. It's time for us to go as far as it takes to change this condition together. Thank you.
Oh, thanks, Suraj, for that. So let's just take a look at that, shall we? Because what I'm really feeling after listening to him and a lot of this morning is that partnership. Partnership is key. It is goal 17. That's what's needed to achieve all the other goals, and it is happening in front of our eyes. And again, this is why I became a journalist, and I'm not on Wheel of Fortune. And again, applause to our partners who are here with us today. Can we just give them a round of applause, everyone involved in the fight? Okay. Now it is my great pleasure to introduce one of our hosts. He is here in the flesh, don't worry. But first, here's a short animated film he's made, dealing with the absolutely key question that we all have to grapple with. Is the world really getting better? Take a look.
We are evolved to solve problems. You know, we're not supposed to wake up in the morning and say, hey, everything's going to be fine. We wake up saying, hey, do we know what we're doing today? Yes, we do. Let's go. We're going to work on something important. If you want to improve the world, you always have to be a little pissed off. That's why these problems get solved, is that there's so much anger that we've come to view inequality is unacceptable. Violence is kind of the extreme example. where the only thing that's gone down faster than violence is people's willingness to accept violence. Their view that it's taboo to, you know, hang witches, have duels, or whip children.
There is a cultural practice of treating each other better.
People are dissatisfied with inequity, but unless you can see that positive trajectory and the fact the world's improving, it can be hard to see that life really is getting better. The big killers, malaria, pneumonia, diarrhea, violence, child to death rate, all those are going down because of better drugs, better vaccines, better nutrition. At least in developed countries, we're so used to child death being very low that a single death is just incredible tragedy. The child to death rate was way worse 20 years ago. Child to deaths is cut in half, which is amazing. The number of lives saved because of that decline dwarfs every other human event. It's pretty mind-blowing. Some things really do go forwards, like human knowledge and scientific understanding. That may sound very abstract, but there are all these good things happening. Food is better, toilets are better, cheap measles vaccines, polio eradication. Regimes have a much harder time suppressing knowledge. Lifespan has doubled in the last 100 years. That's a lot. I celebrate the fact that innovations have brought us longer lives and more nutrition and more freedom. It's this incredibly amazing, positive thing that I think everybody should be in kind of awe and, you know, think how they can help accelerate it. And you always hear about the setbacks, because wars and epidemics are these big setbacks, and feeling super bad about that clouds your overall view. Are we making progress on these things with, you know, some amazing science and incredible heroes out in the field? The answer is overwhelmingly yes. There's a lot of headwinds that make it really hard. I do think convincing people things are improving is pretty important. But I'm not giving up on trying to convince people yet. That's part of my view, is that you can convince people that the world's getting better. We just haven't found that creative way. So I'm counting on you. Good afternoon. You got a little psychedelic view into how my brain works there. You know, my optimism with all those nice colors and everything. And you're going to get a sense over the next hour of why I'm so excited about where we are and where we're going because of four different kinds of innovations. In terms of Love Army, I hope everybody who's watching this on the internet will go to that Love Army Facebook page and help out with that challenge that we heard. And Richard Curtis and the boys will be back after lunch break and update you. And you know, I think we'll have good news on everyone's generosity in achieving those goals. We already heard about progress, both in Melinda's and Stephen's sessions. There were a lot of wonderful things. We are optimistic. We think that progress can actually accelerate. The last 15 years have been wonderful, but the next 15, we can do more. And some people worry that when you talk about progress, that it'll reduce people's commitment to make things better. They think when you talk about progress that it shows you're naive and that maybe you don't realize all those things that are left to be done and how horrific they are. And, you know, so sometimes that purely that negative side of the story gets told. But,
you lose something very important if you only look at it that way. You lose the optimism about what's possible, and you lose the information where you look at the places that have done better than others, and you understand what is it about delivery, innovation, partnerships, caring, what has come together for the very best progress, and then spread that to the other places. That's what will help us drive at full speed. So I have four trends that'll help you understand where these improvements are coming from. And so the first of these is the frontier of science. Science is moving incredibly fast, faster today than ever before. You've got more people in college, more research, more articles being published. This is where we get new drugs, new vaccines, new ways of getting in touch and making sure healthcare workers are doing everything they need to do. This is a key reason why life today is so different than 200 years ago. Even the worst place today has a longer life expectancy than the best had 200 years ago. Second are breakthroughs in delivery. And it's very tough to get things out in developing countries, particularly out in the rural areas. And to have all these advances, have the equity that we all believe in, we need innovations in those delivery things. And so we'll look at some brilliant work being done there. Third is the idea of drawing more people in, having their circle of caring go beyond just their family or even their local community to all of humanity, and how we can take this younger generation, take the new tools that let us see things that are far away and see what's going on, and draw people in with a lot of committed energy. And finally, allies in action partnerships. I believe there's the people who are committed today will get more committed, and that we can draw even more in. Countries like China and India that themselves have set great examples now, helping other countries that have not made as much progress. So the goal in this session is you'll understand why I'm inspired by these things, and you'll think how your work can contribute to these things. So let's dive in on frontiers of science and what we've got there. So there's so many different technologies. Vaccines are probably the top of the list. They're so phenomenal in terms of giving lifelong protection, and their cost has come down and down and down, and we've done a very good job of combining them, so you bring a child in just four times, and they get all the big infectious diseases. They can get protection for those things. The basic metric of success here is the reduction in childhood deaths. It was about 12 million children under 5 died in 1990. Now we're down to fewer than 6 million. And you know, that is really such an incredible thing. And yet if you ask people, if you give them a multiple choice set of answers, almost no one will pick that things have gone this well. They might even think that things have gotten worse because they're reading every day about the setbacks. Now, vaccines, there is a challenge. We're only getting them out to a bit less than 80% of the kids. So we have 20% that don't have access. One of the reasons that it's so hard to get that last 20% is that vaccines have to be kept cold. This is very tough in a place where you have no source of energy, no solar panels, no electricity, no diesel power. For example, in Ethiopia, over 30% of the cold chain equipment is broken. It wasn't designed to work in the tough areas. In India, we went out and surveyed, and about 25% of the vaccines had been exposed to high temperature, and a lot of those were spoiled. So even if they got to the children, they weren't going to have that kind of positive impact that they're supposed to have. So this idea of how do you keep vaccine colds, it was a challenge, kind of a scientific challenge. And that's one of the things our foundation likes to do is really educate scientists on what ideas they could work on that would make a huge difference, because they don't get to go out in the poor world and see what would really have the big impact. And so here, a cold chain was put forward. There's a group of inventors that work at a group called Global Good that I support, and they came up with a number of ideas. So you'll hear from a couple of the inventors, and they're really made a lot of progress. They have things that are ready to go out in the field, and it's very exciting. So let me welcome Jenny Hu. Hey, Jenny.
Every year, vaccines save millions of lives. But they're finicky. They must be kept in a narrow temperature range between 2 and 8 degrees Celsius in order to work properly. If they get too warm or too cold, they don't work and they don't protect against disease. They have to stay in this temperature range in an uninterrupted cold chain that reaches from the factory all the way to the clinic or health post where they're actually delivered to the children. These health posts can be in a lot of different areas. Some of them are in cities, areas where you might have reliable electricity. Some of them are in more remote places where the grid could be unreliable, frequent outages. And some of them don't have any electricity at all. They're off-grid. Each country could have over 10,000 of these facilities, each serving several thousand people. And I've visited some of these clinics. I've met mothers who carry their children several kilometers to be there to get their vaccines. But all too often, they find out when they get there, the refrigerator is broken, the vaccines are spoiled, and they've just wasted their time. And I've seen at these clinics piles of broken refrigerators that just get shoved outside because they're not working, they're not doing their job, they're not keeping the vaccines cold. And this is an example of an ice-lined refrigerator. This is old technology that's been around for a while, but it's got a few problems. So something like this can sometimes keep the vaccines too cold and freeze them. At the same time, it doesn't keep them cold for long enough when the power goes out, and it's vulnerable to power fluctuations, so they can break easily. And sometimes they just aren't properly designed for the environment. So this one, for example, we found at a clinic. Africa brought it here to show you. It's got missing covers. Probably it overheated and had to get more ventilation in there. It's rusting from the humidity. I've actually been at clinics and we've seen refrigerators that are so big they don't fit through clinic doors and had to be left outside. And so these are problems that my group wanted to address, and we did that by building a better refrigerator. We call it the MetaFridge, and here it is. This MetaFridge just started as an idea 4.5 years ago, but I actually started building the first prototypes in my apartment closet before moving to a garage. We built our own environmental chamber to do the testing, but our test, it worked out, and we've been able to improve and make progress, and we've moved to a research lab, built a great team that's been working on this. Some of them are actually on helping out today, and more around the world. So the first challenge that we wanted to address with this was how to keep vaccines cold when the power is going out all the time. The fridge in your house is only going to keep your food cold for a couple of hours during a power outage. Something like an ice-lined refrigerator will give you a day or two. But we actually went out, we measured power in a whole bunch of different countries, and we've seen outages that lasted 5 days or even more. So we thought about how to address that problem. So this refrigerator plugs into the wall, like a regular refrigerator, but what it does with that power is make ice. And this whole top of the fridge is actually full of ice. Our innovation was to add a thermosiphon, like this, that's actually inside the fridge. And it's basically a sealed tube, it's got some fluid inside, and it super efficiently takes heat from the bottom of the fridge in the vaccine chamber and moves it up towards that ice block. We've got an infrared video that shows you how that process works. So up top, you've got that cold, you've got ice up here, and when the thermosiphon is activated, you can see the cold front moving down, and that's heat being sucked out of the vaccine chamber, moved up through the thermosiphon to the ice block, where it slowly melts that ice over a long period of time. So this thermosiphon technology allows us to keep the vaccines at exactly the right temperature, really stably, without any power at all. So when this ice is fully frozen, when the power goes out, their vaccines will stay at that temperature for 5 to 9 days, depending on the ambient temperature. This unit here, we actually just plugged in for a few hours on Monday afternoon, and it's been unplugged since then. It's still at 4 degrees, and it's probably going to stay there for another week. The next problem that we tackled was power fluctuations. We've been out and seen a lot of different places where the grid is really unreliable. Power fluctuates, we have what's called brownouts, where there's too much load on the grid and the voltage drops. And then when the voltage comes back on, you'll often see spikes, surges that can be several times the nominal voltage. And all of these things break components, break fridges, lead to those piles of broken equipment not doing the job. So this fridge has an integrated power system. It's actually built in, so it's always protecting the fridge. It keeps it safe from those surges. And when you, not only that, when the voltage is high or low, instead of being broken, this fridge can harness that energy and keep running. We've tested in areas where the voltage is a third of what it should be, and this fridge just keeps on running and keeps the vaccine safe. Another thing that we've done is we know that we're engineers working in Seattle, and we don't always know what's best for everybody. We want to go out and we learn from people. So we put these prototypes out in field sites, out in clinics, talked to a lot of nurses, technicians, got feedback about what was working and what we could do better. One of the things we found out is that nurses often just have no way to know about their environment. They don't know how long the power may have been on or off. They might see from the thermometer inside that the refrigerator is cold now. But if they go home for the evening, they don't know what temperature their vaccines are going to be when they come back. The power might have gone out overnight, and they could come back to spoiled vaccines. So what we've done is built in an integrated real-time monitoring system. It's got temperature sensors. It knows when the power is on or off, and it'll tell you about it. It's got a display here. So if I'm a nurse, I can look at this display, and before I go home on a Friday morning, I can see this refrigerator is going to stay cold for 5 more days. So I can go home with confidence. I know that when I come back in, my vaccines are going to be safe. And if I even get a text message, I can see that this refrigerator might have a problem, and I can tell a technician, but I know I have a few days to get that service before the vaccines are ever at risk. So that's the Metafridge. There's a lot of really cool technology in here, and we're engineers, we love technology, but we know that technology isn't always enough. We wanted to make sure this became a product, and went into clinics and was actually working with people and be able to do its job. So we've been spending a lot of time over the last couple of years working with a manufacturing partner, going back and forth to the factory, making sure that this is actually mass producible, but still high quality and affordable. And today, I can tell you this Metafridge is in production. It's in use in clinics, actually helping more kids get vaccinated. However, not every child who needs vaccines can make their way to a clinic. Sometimes we actually have to take the vaccines and bring them out to the children. So that's what my colleague Morgan Fowler is working on.
Thanks, Jenny. So in many parts of the world, kids live in places that are too remote to access the vaccine clinics. In these areas, the vaccinators take the vaccines directly out to the kids, closer to the kids, out to the remote vaccination sites. About 50% of vaccines in Africa are delivered in this manner. Consider the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Here, kids really need their mobile vaccinators because this is one of the most geographically and logistically challenging countries to work in. It's the largest country in sub-Saharan Africa, yet has few roads. Vaccinators use hand-drawn maps, like this one, to find where they're supposed to go. This is Papa Blondine Mumbwe. She's been a vaccinator for 10 years in the DRC, covering part of a region of 125,000 people, using the same old vaccine carrier technology that vaccinators across Africa have been using for the past 50 years. This is a problem particularly in Blondine's region, because there's no power grid, few roads, and no cars. Only 8 of 21 health posts in Blondine's region have any kind of refrigeration at all. The ice pack vaccine carriers just don't do a good enough job in order to reach the next level of vaccine coverage. So I saw these limitations firsthand while in Uganda about 7 years ago. And it was clear to me then that what's really needed is vaccine carriers that have no need for any ice at all. And so that's what I and a team around the world have been working on for the past couple of years. And I want to show you what we've done. This is the Indigo vaccine cooler. It does what nothing else in the world currently does. This cooler will keep vaccines at the right temperature for a long period of time with absolutely no ice, no batteries, and no electricity needed during cooling. No infrastructure at all. And you're looking at one of the very first ones that exist in the world out of a factory instead of out of a machine shop. The rest of them that exist are off in Africa doing what they do best, vaccinating kids. It's really easy to use. When you want to make the cooling start, you open a mechanical valve like this, and the cooling starts. When you don't want cooling, pull it out. No electricity needed at all, and when the valve is turned off, the cooler can sit on the shelf, somewhere remote, using absolutely none of its cooling energy. When you need cooling, just turn it on with the turn of the valve. The unit is also rechargeable. You can put it in something like a kiln that will heat it up and make it ready for a whole nother cycle. So there you go. Vaccines at the right temperature, at the right time, with absolutely no ice, no electricity, and no batteries. But how do we do this? So we start with something like a thermos. It limits the amount of heat that comes into the unit. And then, instead of adding ice to make it cold, we actually have an internally built layer of water on the inside that we keep at a very low pressure, which makes the water evaporate at a very low temperature, 5 degrees Celsius, the perfect temperature for vaccine storage. So, what does this look like in the world? What does the future look like with the Indigo cooler? Well, let's meet somebody who's actually using them in the field. Please join me in welcoming Blondine, Papa Blondine, and her husband David from the DRC. Bienvenue, Blondine and David. Et merci. Blondine has been participating in a field test in the DRC where we have taken all of the ice pack carriers and replaced them with these brand new Indigo coolers. 8 coolers covering a population of 125,000 people. And already, vaccinators are reaching kids that have not been reached before. Before we started this field test, the vaccinators reached about 20 of these remote vaccination sites in a month's time period. But now, this month, in September, they expect to be able to reach 120 remote vaccination sites due to the capabilities of the Indigo cooler. Our goal is that soon all vaccinators across Africa will have access to the Metafridge, the Indigo, and other advanced cooling technologies in order to vaccinate all kids. Thank you for being here today.
So Blondine, I'm curious, how has the Indigo changed the way that you're able to go out and provide vaccines?
L'Indigo nous a beaucoup aidé dans mon aire de santé. Ça nous a aidé de vacciner les enfants qui sont loin dans mon aire de santé. Et avec son autonomie de 5 jours, ça nous aide de récupérer les enfants qui ont manqué à être vaccinés. Et ça nous aide aussi à donner un bon vaccin à la population et à augmenter la couverture vaccinale.
The Indigo has helped me tremendously because it has helped me to reach the children that are in remote villages of difficult access. Also, with its 5-day autonomy, we can reach children that have been missed in previous campaigns, and also to have access to quality vaccine and thus increase vaccine coverage.
Well, that's fantastic. I want to thank David, Blondine, Morgan, Jenny, and all the inventors at Global Good for working on this very tough problem of getting vaccines out to every child. Thank you. Both the Metafridge and the Indigo are going to be available in the atrium between now and 3 p.m. So if you want to go take a look and see the great engineering there and hear how we're actually getting out into the field in large numbers, they'd love to talk to you about that. Well, so innovation has been so amazing, and not only vaccines, but also drugs. Perhaps most prominently, getting the triple drug therapy, the antiretroviral virals, down in cost and getting those out to millions of people. It's a story of science, it's a story of generosity, but it's a story that still has a lot that we need to do. Here's a chart that's out of the Goalkeepers report. That's the report we put out last week. For those of you who haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. This is the first time we've been able to take a lot of the key issues and not only document where the progress has come, but also look at the future to do some forecasting. And we take assumptions, positive assumptions, and show with kind of a green area what happens if we do things well, and in a red area, what if we take off the pressure and we aren't pushing forward. And you could say the theme of today's event is to make sure that we're, for all the different areas, achieving that green instead of the red. But let's look specifically at HIV. Of course, before 2005, what you see is really quite horrific. This is the number of HIV/AIDS deaths, the rate, and it went up very, very dramatically and peaked in about 2005. 2005 is where the world made the commitment to get these low-cost drugs out to as many people as possible. And something wondrous took place. The number of deaths came down quite dramatically. And so that is super good news. We had funding, we had commitment, we had people thinking about how to get those drugs out there. But looking from this point forward, there really is a risk that death rate could go back up. Part of that is that we have much larger population size. The number of people in the youth cohort who are most at risk has expanded very dramatically. And so we are challenged to maintain the funding. The red line, actually the line, the one that's the worst there, is where we took and put into this model the United States, which is by far the biggest funder of getting these medicines out, if it went through with the cut that was in a proposed budget. And what that would mean is over 5 million more deaths between now and 2030. And so this field, we've had generous funding. In fact, the greatest single additional funding for any sort of aid or health type issue is what took place through Global Fund and PEPFAR. Now, that funding, in the best case, will go up slightly, but not as quickly as the number of people we have living with HIV. And this idea of how do we treat more people, keep them compliant with the medicine to protect both themselves and make sure they don't spread the disease, that's an area where we need lots of innovation. Now, I've been very lucky to go out into the field and meet people who are trying out different approaches. To see where in all the world, but particularly in Africa, where are they achieving this high compliance in a very efficient way. We had a meeting about that topic in Tanzania 3 years ago, and that's where I met Tom Ellman. Our HIV team had seen his work and really thought I should know about it, and that conversation was a very big catalyst for us. Although we're not a direct funder of Doctors Without Borders, we've decided to take a big role in trying to get this approach out to as many places as possible. And I think you'll be very impressed, like I was, at what he's doing in the field. So please welcome Dr. Tom Ellman of Doctors Without Borders.
I should start by saying it's not really my work, it's the work of many, many thousands of people working with us and our partners in the field. I'm afraid I haven't got any gadgets or a motorbike, which is a shame. The problem with doctors, and I'm one, is that we think we know it all. I guess some of you have met a doctor. We don't like trusting patients. We've had a long training, they haven't. We're professionals, they're not. And this attitude has informed HIV treatment for decades. Testing could only be done by a specialist counselor. You had to see a specialist doctor in a centralized clinic who was the only one who had the holy grail of these antiretroviral drugs. And you had to return every month to get your drugs. And it worked. We had impressive successes. There are now 19 million people on treatment. Over half of the people who need treatment are on it. But the global target, the global goals target, is to leave no one behind. And right now, we still have more than 20,000 people a week dying of AIDS. Something has to change. I want to talk briefly about our experience in Mozambique in Southeast Africa, where MSF has been working with the Ministry of Health treating HIV since 2003. At first, the model followed the usual pattern, so we had centralized clinics hugely overloaded with thousands of people. Staff could only spend a couple of minutes with each patient, so they missed the sick ones because they were too busy with just filling out the paperwork. And patients had to travel for hours on foot every month to come to this clinic and pay for the transport. They had to queue. Not surprisingly, up to a third, I would have dropped out, up to a third of them dropped out within a year of treatment. The system was not fit for purpose. Around 2007, a small group of patients from remote villages around Tet decided to break the rules. Rather than walking for hours every month, they formed small groups, and in rotation, one of the group members would go and pick up drugs for the others. It sounds so obvious, but what was special here was that rather than the doctors doing the usual thing, saying, no, no, you have to follow the system, this is how it works, they listened. And this became the way that they worked in Tet. That was the start of the community antiretroviral treatment groups. Now, since then, this kind of approach has become known as differentiated care, and it's being adapted by many different organizations and governments in different ways and settings. The CAGs are just one of many examples. One size doesn't fit all. And the essence of the models is very simple. You listen to patients, you trust what they say, and you adapt your services to their needs. Bottom up, simplified, demedicalized. Who provides care? Rather than a specialized doctor coming to see you each time, nurses can initiate care. And peers, people like you, can learn to deliver the drugs. They can look after your basic needs, counseling, and provide support. Where's care provided? Closer to home. In Kinshasa, in Congo, we've developed a system of community-based pharmacies run by patient groups. How often do you have to see a nurse or doctor? Well, come if you're sick, but if you're well, why would you come to the clinic? Come once a year. And in between, let's make sure we give the drugs for as long as possible, long refills, and if you have to come, there's a fast-track service, so you can pick up your drugs quickly rather than waiting. And unsurprisingly, the results are much better. We have data from a variety of approaches in different settings across Southern Africa, showing this, that the visit costs are less for both the patient and for the system. There's less time spent by the patient, who doesn't need to spend a long away from their family, and by the staff, who can focus on the patients more in need, people more likely to die. And in the green, the most important thing, this is from Tet actually, that retention after 4 years is much better. Less than 10% of people were lost to follow-up after 4 years in treatment. And perhaps most importantly, these things are being scaled up. Governments are listening, and across Africa and across Mozambique, the CAGs were taken up nationally, and this is from South Africa, where another form, the adherence clubs, have been rolled out across the Western Cape and are becoming the standard of care for all stable patients. Perhaps most importantly, these models can build networks of empowered patients, a social fabric to help break the stigma and for people to support each other in dealing with the barriers they face. I know how this sounds coming from me, a white male European doctor. Casildo Fumo, someone who used to work with us in Mozambique, can describe much better than me. She can't be here, but we have a short video to show of Casilda.
Me chamo Casilda Micachuma. Eu sou um estrela grave, eu sou só positiva desde 2002. Pensei que ia ver de morrer. Mas sabe, o galo ao cantar, o resto eu tenho que despertar, senão a verdade passar, sou vivo ou não. Mas pronto, fui ganhando tempo também, descobri que tinha outras pessoas. Então foram meus amigos aí, para nos unirmos as forças. Todos os dias, medicamentos, ajudamos a pessoa a ficar forte, sabendo que não sou sozinho. Nos gregos somos família. Eu, quando tomo os meus comprimidos, sinto-me a fortificar mais a minha energia para ter mais força e ser mais saudável. Eu, quando tomo comprimido, penso que as pessoas não estão a direito tratamento com muita pena, pois estão a perder a oportunidade de que ainda têm de viver neste mundo tão lindo. As pessoas, quando existem tratamento, outros morrem. Se for falar do número de buscas, como se põe mais ou menos 500, ou se apostarmos 500, ajudamos mais 500. Boa, amor.
Imagine what could be achieved if we put more power into people like Casilda's hands, the tools that they need, the knowledge and the funding. But there's a problem with this system. It has strings attached. In order to get into it, you already had to be on treatment and stable on treatment. You had to be someone the staff trusted. You were coming regularly. They decided whether you got in or not. In other words, you already had to get past numerous barriers that people face in accessing treatment. If we're to leave no one behind, we need to go much further. We need to adapt these systems to make sure that they work for people who can't pass even the first hurdles of getting tested and getting onto treatment. We need to adapt them for the hundreds of millions left behind in conflict zones, in fragile states, for migrants and refugees, the kind of settings where Médecins Sans Frontières spends most of its time working. In Western Central Africa, people are left behind. 30% of all HIV deaths occur in Western Central Africa. We need to adapt for adolescent girls, who are among the most at risk of HIV. For men, we need to adapt for critical and excluded, criminalized populations, like sex workers, like men who have sex with men, like drug users, transgender populations. Nowhere is peer-led delivery, that someone who, like you, needs to be involved in delivering your care, more important than amongst these groups. Imagine having to rely on a health system that treats you as a criminal. It's impossible to imagine getting care in that kind of system. For prisoners, for the sick, and those who've fallen out of treatment, we need to find ways to welcome them back into treatment. Because to reduce mortality, we have to adapt our care to their needs. And we need to adapt the approaches for other diseases. And there are many examples. Tuberculosis, an ancient disease, remains a global emergency and has overtaken HIV, killing 1.8 million people every year. But TB still functions in many countries on the basis of mistrust. You have to be witnessed, direct observation, taking every pill. Surely more could be done to bring the differentiated care and patient empowerment principles to TB. Family planning. Young women and adolescent girls who want contraception must still rely on busy and often judgmental professionals in clinics to get what they need, and their needs are not being met. Whether gender equality, inequality, conservative attitudes, or politics, like the US global gag rule, prevent access to contraception or safe abortion. Wherever these things happen, women and girls are dying. Differentiated care principles can put control back into their hands. The vision, then, is that we develop a system based on trust and a partnership between professionals and communities, We build it based on very simple, easy-to-use diagnostic tools, like self-tests. Anyone can use them. Safe, long-acting drugs and supply systems that take them directly to the hands of the patients, not just to the clinics. And we need research and development systems that will focus on developing tools based on these needs, even where there's no profit to be made from them. Health professionals must be willing to give up some control, to share knowledges and tools with their patients. And we need more funding. HIV funding has fallen in the last 2 years to levels not seen since 2010. If PEPFAR is focused overly on the 13 countries, what's going to be happening to the other countries? Are they going to be left behind? We do need more doctors and nurses and community health workers, hospitals and clinics properly equipped to save lives. We need more better paid frontline health workers, but focusing on patients who really need their help. And finally, we need to invest in peer leadership, in community activism, patient empowerment. And this is a critical role for the international community, because national governments, whether they're in rich countries or poor countries, rarely want to fund those groups that hold them accountable for people left behind. Meeting the global goals will depend on action by these empowered communities. Without their voices, the HIV response might never have started. But with them, leave no one behind can be more than just a slogan. Thanks.
Well, that was very powerful and exciting. Well, our next speaker has had quite a varied career. He started his business career copying pirated music. He went on to comedy. Now he's an international comedy star. He hosts an Emmy-winning TV show. He's got a fantastic number one best-selling book. He speaks 8 languages, so kind of an underachiever. But I'm a huge fan of his. I read the book. It's funny and insightful, but also very profound, telling his own story and other people's stories. He's encouraging people around the world to expand their circles of giving. So I'm excited to welcome Trevor Noah.
Thank you again, Bill. And Melinda for having me here. Good morning / afternoon, everybody. Good to have you. This is weird because I'm just going to talk to your phones and we're right here. It's a strange experience. Welcome to the millennial age. Yeah, you'll have the picture and you'll show it to your friend and they'll go, what did he look like in person? You go, I don't know. I was also looking at my phone when I showed it, when I should have been there with him. First of all, thank you very much, Bill and Melinda, for having me. When I was first asked to be here, they said, hey, we want you to come and speak at this event, you know, Goalkeepers, and talk about what's happening in the world. And I looked through all of the people who were speaking, and I said, but I have nothing. I do not have a fridge that can change lives. I do not have a plan to eradicate HIV in South Africa and in Southern Africa and the rest of the continent. And I most definitely cannot ride a motorbike, so I don't know what I can do for you. Bill just said, just come and share your thoughts, your stories, your ideas. And that's how I process information. That's how I process my world. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself and why Goalkeepers mean so much to me. So in case you don't know me, my name is Trevor Noah. I grew up in South Africa during a time known as apartheid. And for those who don't know, apartheid was a system of laws which made it illegal for black people and white people to integrate with each other, amongst other things. You know, black people lived in separate areas to white people. They had different rules. They were segregated. And this was particularly tough for me because I grew up in a mixed family, right? Well, with me being the mixed one in the family. My mother's a black woman, Hausa woman from South Africa. And in case you're wondering, Hausa is one of the languages with the clicks in it. Hausa. Right? Hausa. But not like in American movies. I've seen those movies where they have the Africans and they're like, no, 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 no. That's not a language, all right? No, even we watch those movies and we're like, I wonder what they're saying, yeah? It's not a language. But my mother's a Xhosa woman, South African. My father's Swiss from Switzerland, and was a white man, and so, well, still is a white man. He didn't change. And so they got together during this time, which was against the law, and they had me. And, you know, it wasn't easy growing up in this family, and that's really where our journey began. Because we were a family that couldn't be together. We were a family that was, for all intents and purposes, a crime that existed. Me being born from my mother, because of my father, was me being born a crime. And, you know, one of the biggest things I connected with when, you know, reading about Goalkeepers and learning about the organization was the optimism, was the ability to see what no one could see at a time when no one should almost have the right to see it. My mother was one of those people. You know, my mother's a beautiful, powerful woman who endured a lot during her life. You know, we lived through apartheid in South Africa. We lived through her going on to marry a man who was extremely abusive and alcoholic. And throughout all of that, the one thing that I always admired in my mom was that she had the ability to appreciate the reality of the world she was in, but also optimistically pursue the future that she wished to exist in. And that's for me what Goalkeepers is all about, optimism. You know, people always ask, they go, is the world going to be in a better place? Is the world getting better or is it getting worse? Now, depending on who you ask, there will always be a different answer. I've come to find one of the reasons I believe the world is getting better is because we have access to information on how bad the world actually is, which I know is a strange thing to say, but that's honestly what I believe. As a young person, and as someone who makes a show for young people, one of the most powerful tools I've realized is information. We come from an age where there was misinformation, disinformation, and there is some of it today. But now, more than ever, young people communicate across borders, across continents. You see people in England and in America and South Africa tweeting, talking to people in Myanmar. You see people speaking out about what they see happening in Sudan. You see people commiserating and sharing with victims of hurricanes across the Caribbean or across Texas. And whenever I look at that, I go, it's one of the most powerful tools that, if harnessed correctly, can lead to a completely new way that we communicate and we change the world. You know, and young people are driven. That's one of the most beautiful things I've realized is we live in a new age. You know, millennials oftentimes are mocked. You know, they say they're lazy, they believe that they're entitled, and, you know, they cry about small things, which is true, but they're also driven. They also wish to make a change. They also believe that they can make a change. And I believe that information and these tools that we possess today have helped increase that. You know, more than ever, we see that in America. You know, as the host of The Daily Show, I'm obviously in a world where we comment on news and politics. And one thing I've noticed with my audience is not only are young people growing into the world of politics, but they're engaged in a way that people were never engaged before, engaged in a way where they understand that they can actually change the course of history as opposed to just being a part of it. It's a beautiful experience to see that's taking place across continents. In my home country, South Africa, we see the same thing. Young people standing up and saying, we don't accept the status quo. We can change our destiny. We can change the future. We can be a part of this world. And essentially, that's what's happening in America right now. You feel it. You know, people always come up to me and they go, Trevor, as the host of The Daily Show, how do you feel about Donald Trump? And I say, well, I don't know how to feel about him. That's the honest truth. He's a paradox for me emotionally. You know, one part of me is terrified at the notion that he is president of the most powerful nation in the world. The other side of me knows that every day he's going to make me laugh. I cannot deny this. The best way I can put it is, it's almost like there's a giant asteroid headed towards the Earth, but it's shaped like a penis. I think I'm gonna die, but I know I'm gonna laugh. And this is a tough place to be in, because you have to process the very real situation that you are in, and that is a dangerous one, but at the same time you can acknowledge that when you laugh, you're not controlled by fear. And that's something that I've always lived with in my life, in my family. You know, my mother always said to me, she said, when we are laughing, we're not afraid. When we are laughing, we are experiencing our truest selves. It doesn't mean what is happening to us is not real, but it means that we can process the very real world that is to us. And in many ways, I try and look at the positives. People go, is the world getting better? I go, I believe it's always getting better, but in many ways, the world is like the body. You cannot see the change when you look at it every single day, but if you take snapshots, you can see how things are getting better. You can also see how some things are getting worse. Climate change is one of those. And that's where young people are stepping up and saying, hey, hurricanes are a good example. Oh, you know, the intensity of these once-in-a-lifetime events has increased. Maybe it's time to do something. Young people are speaking up. Donald Trump is doing that. People are speaking up. They're engaging like never before. You know, for the first time in history, we're living through a time period where we're learning about the presidency at the same time as the president, which is engaging people like never before. You wake up, you read the newspaper, and you go, I've never knew this before. And somewhere at that exact same moment, the president is reading that same newspaper, saying the exact same thing. And that for me is exciting. Is it scary? Yes. But most exciting things are scary. But honestly, I saw it over the last few weeks, and I mean, it's still unfolding now. You have, you know, Hurricane Maria, which is wrecking havoc and moving, you know, to Puerto Rico now, and we're seeing the devastation. But we've also seen the giving. You know, I was touched by how many people, even on our show, reached out. And there is an opportunity for everyone to become a goalkeeper, which is what excites me. And that is, in this new world of technology, we have the opportunity to engage with activists on the ground level. People often mock millennials and they say these are hashtag activists. And I argue they're hashtag activists until they're given the opportunity to take it from a tweet into the streets. And so I urge every single one of you in this room, if you have the power, if you have the ability, if you have the information or the knowledge, take these people up on what they're offering. They're energized. They're optimistic, they're powerful beyond all measure, and I'm proud to say that I'm one of them. I'm a millennial, and by proxy, I hope to be a goalkeeper. Thank you very much for having me, and congratulations on everything today.
Well, we get now to the fourth and final thing that makes me excited about where we're going. And this is allies in action. Foundations, corporations, governments, and individuals working together. We've heard about a few of these kind of new partnerships with the accelerators that were announced today. And now I get to announce our final speaker. Barack Obama has dedicated his career to helping people improve their lives, first as a community organizer, then as a state senator, a U.S. senator, and then, of course, as the 44th president of the United States. I got to meet with President Obama a number of times, and I was always impressed by how he wasn't discouraged, even when tough challenges came along. He stayed focused on the work. He did what he could to make positive change. And now he's continuing that incredible commitment with the Obama Foundation. Please welcome former President Barack Obama.
Hello, hello, hello. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, please, everybody have a seat. Have a seat. We got work to do here. Thank you, Bill, for that introduction. More importantly, thank you and Melinda for your tireless efforts towards making a better world. I've been reading about these goalkeepers. You guys are pretty inspirational. And I am excited to be here with you. And whether it's girls' education or global health or climate change, you're setting a standard for the sorts of innovation and persistence and activism that the world desperately needs right now. So I could not be prouder. And that's really what I'm going to talk about very briefly before I have a chance for a discussion with Bill and Melinda. I want to talk about changing the world. I remember sitting down with Bill in Paris a couple of years ago, where the world was coming together to hammer out an agreement, a small agreement to save the planet. by taking meaningful action to tackle climate change. It's a threat that may define the contours of this century more than just about anything else. Here was the interesting thing. Bill saw this not simply as a challenge, but also as an opportunity. And I remember him in sort of a matter-of-fact way saying, well, we're going to just have to go ahead and invent some new technologies, which I said, I agree. Let's do that. Although he knows more than me about inventing new technologies. But his tone was, yes, this is hard, but we can figure it out. It's hard, but it can be done. And that spirit, a spirit that says, to quote, I guess myself, yes, we can, rather than a spirit of despair, is the motor by which we've been able to see real progress in reducing the pace of carbon emission increases here in the U.S. And even if at the current moment the federal government is not as engaged in these efforts as I would like, nevertheless, progress continues because of the efforts of people like Bill and a whole host of entrepreneurs and universities and cities and states. They are making change around energy policy in America, separate and apart from what government is doing. And that gives me confidence that we can continue to make progress. And my broader point here is that you tend to believe when Bill says we can do something, that we can do it. And when all of you stand up and say this is something we can do, that spirit is infectious. And it's exactly what we need right now. We do face extraordinary challenges. You've heard of many of them in your discussions today. You know the nature of these challenges from your work. Growing economic inequality, a changing climate, terrorism, mass migration, still too much extreme poverty, still too many girls who are denied an education, the rise of nationalism and xenophobia, and a politics that says it's not we, but us and them. A politics that threatens to turn good people away from the kind of collective action that has always driven human progress. So these are real challenges, and we can't sugarcoat them. They're going to take a long time to solve. But that can't discourage any of us from the belief that individually and collectively, we can make a difference. We can make things better. And rather than be daunted by those challenges should inspire us and excite us, because it gives us an opportunity to make our mark on the world in ways that we haven't even yet scratched the surface of. We have to reject the notion that we're suddenly gripped by forces that we cannot control. We've got to embrace the longer and more optimistic view of history and the part that we play in it. And if you are skeptical of such optimism, I will say something that may sound controversial. I used to say this to my staff in the White House, young interns who would come in, any group of young people that I met with, and that is that by just about every measure, America is better and the world is better than it was 50 years ago, 30 years ago, or even 10 years ago. And I know that statement doesn't jibe with the steady stream of bad news and cynicism that we're fed through television and Twitter, but think about it. I was born, I know I have gray hair, but I don't consider myself that old. But I was born at a time when women and people of color were systematically, routinely, excluded from enormous portions of American life. Today, women and minorities have risen up the ranks of business and politics and everywhere else. And even if we still have miles to travel, and innumerable laws and hearts and minds to change, the shift in what this country is and what it means is astonishing, remarkable, and it's happened, when you measure it against the scope of human history, in an instant. Just since I graduated from college, crime rates, teen birth rates, dropout rates, the share of people living in poverty have dropped, and in some cases, dropped dramatically. The share of Americans with college education is up, despite a massive global recession. In the final years of my presidency, the uninsured rate reached a new low. Median household income reached a new high. That's here in the United States. Worldwide, our progress is even more remarkable. And Bill can rattle off these statistics better than I can. But over the past 100 years, we've come from a world where only a small fraction of women could vote to a world where almost every woman can. Since the 1950s, the global average life expectancy has grown by more than 20 years. Since 1990, we have cut extreme poverty and childhood mortality in half. Keep in mind, I was in law school in 1990. It seems like yesterday. Since 2000, we've evolved from a world without marriage equality to one where it's a reality in more than two dozen countries. All of this has happened in such a steady march that sometimes we have a tendency to take it for granted. But I often ask when I meet with young people, if you had to choose any moment in history in which to be born, and you didn't know in advance whether you were going to be male or female, what country you were going to be from, what your status was, you'd choose right now, because the world has never been healthier or wealthier or better educated, or in many ways more tolerant or less violent than it is today. Fewer people are dying young. More people are living not only longer but better. More girls are in school. More adults can read. More children get the vaccines that they need. Despite the enormous conflicts that break our hearts around the world, it's demonstrable that fewer people are being killed in wars and conflicts than ever before. This would be the time you'd want to be showing up on this planet. And these trends are real. They do not make us complacent, but they should spur us to action, because it shows, despite the naysayers and the cynicism, that in fact change can happen. They're not the result of mysterious forces of chance. They happen because countless people like you, toiling for many years, chose to make this progress. Some, like Bill and Melinda, have enormous wealth and influence. Others, like Justin Trudeau, who I know addressed you earlier, have formal political offices. But the majority of people who made these advances were citizens, doctors, nurses, entrepreneurs, clergy, moms, community leaders, activists, union leaders, who mobilized and organized and voted and innovated and pushed for change. And by the way, they knew at every step of the way that they would not get everything they wanted as fast as they wanted. They knew that progress required struggle and perseverance and discipline and faith. They knew that sometimes for every two steps forward, you'll take a step back. But they made things better. And this is something I always had to emphasize to my staff when I was president. Better is good. No, you laugh, but sometimes people forget that. I will take better every time. So that's what's needed today. The engagement of everyone who wants to see a better future for our children. And it can be frustrating. I'll take an example here in the United States. Over the past 8 years, thousands upon thousands of Americans threw themselves into the collective effort of reforming our healthcare system. Those of you who live in countries that already have universal healthcare are trying to figure out what's the controversy here. I am too. But, you know, the folks who did the work, it wasn't just policy wonks. It wasn't just politicians. It was moms and dads, people who had the experience of a sick child or crushing medical bills that threatened to bankrupt them. Maybe a parent who was lost to a cancer that, had that person got a regular checkup, might have been caught earlier. And those voices from every walk of life in every corner of the country, against all odds, made a difference. And for the first time, more than 90% of Americans know the security of health insurance. Paying more for insurance or being denied insurance because of a pre-existing condition or because you are a woman, that's not a thing anymore. We got rid of that. And people are alive today because of it, and that's progress. Now, the legislation that we passed was full of things that still need to be fixed. It wasn't perfect, but it was better. And so when I see people trying to undo that hard-won progress for the 50th or 60th time with bills that would raise costs or reduce coverage or roll back protections for older Americans or people with pre-existing conditions, the cancer survivor, the expecting mom, or the child with autism or asthma, for whom coverage once again would be almost unattainable, it is aggravating. And all of this being done without any demonstrable economic or actuarial or plain common sense rationale, it frustrates. And it's certainly frustrating to have to mobilize every couple of months to keep our leaders from inflicting real human suffering on our constituents. But, you know, typically that's how progress is won and how progress is maintained. On every issue, we have to stand up for each other, recognize that progress is never inevitable, that it often can be fragile, it's in need of constant renewal, and our individual progress and our collective progress depends on our willingness to roll up our sleeves and work. And not be afraid to work. So, in conclusion, each of us can make a difference, and I know I'm preaching to the choir here, because otherwise you wouldn't be a goalkeeper. But many of you are young and maybe have only seen forward momentum and may not have seen backward momentum yet. Many of you may confront hurdles and roadblocks and disappointments in the future. And when that happens, that's the test. The test is not how do you feel when things are going good or when you are at a cool conference in New York with Bill and Melinda Gates and Will.i.am. Right? The test is when you're in the field and you're on the ground and you are doing work and people are resisting or misunderstanding or purposely undermining efforts that you know can make a difference. And how do you respond to that? And what I'm suggesting here today is that your response has to be to reject cynicism and reject pessimism and push forward with a certain infectious and relentless optimism. Not blind optimism, not one that ignores the scale and the scope of challenges, but that hard-earned optimism that's rooted in the stories of very real progress that have occurred throughout human history. And the recognition that our successes, even though sometimes they're small or incomplete, accumulate, they build, and they create a trajectory that's better and will mean some girl somewhere getting an education that otherwise she wouldn't have had. That'll mean some farmer being able to cultivate a crop to feed his family, and if enough of them do it, feed a nation. That's what you're fighting for at every moment. Because each new generation stands on the successes of the previous generation. It's like a relay race that we're running. Each generation reaches up, standing on that previous generation, and bends that arc of history in the direction of more freedom and more opportunity and more justice. That's why I spend so much time, when I was president, convening young leaders on every continent that I visited. That's why in my post-presidency, my emphasis is going to be on training the next generation of leaders to take their own crack at changing the world through the Obama Foundation, which will be based in Chicago, but will have projects and programs and digital networks all across the globe. And I'm hoping I get a chance to work with some of you, because I have great faith in you, just as I know Bill and Melinda have great faith in you. And I'm certain that if you keep pushing forward, then America and the world are going to be just fine. Thank you very much. You have some theme music here. That's good.
those were incredibly inspiring remarks, I think, for all of us.
And Rob, she's using
one of the things that strikes me in the conversations we've had in this room today, as you know earlier, as you said, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau
was here. I said it when I came back here.
You know, he started with youth movements in his own country and rose to be the Prime Minister. You started with as a community organizer and rose to be President. You understand the power of moving people along, even people who aren't necessarily on your bus when you start. Talk to us a little bit about how you think of movements around the world and the power of those now, and what leaders can learn from them.
Well, I'd make a couple of observations. Number one is that most big change, most human progress is driven by young people who don't know any better and figure, why can't we do something different? Old people get comfortable or cranky or protective of their status or set in their ways. There's a reason why, if you look at, for example, here in the United States, the civil rights movement, the leaders of those movements were in their 20s. Dr. King was 26 when he started, 39 when he was killed. And if you canvass the world, oftentimes that is the impetus. People asking in ways that I think are familiar to many, not why not. Why do things have to be the way they are? So that's point number one, that young people, I think, can make an enormous difference. Number two is that because most of us now either live in democracies or countries that purport to be democracies, because we have won the battle of ideas that says governments and our common efforts have to be rooted in the legitimacy of people, there is more power than ever in people being able to band together and collectively push for initiatives that are going to make change in their lives. That's something that for most of human history was unimaginable That is one of the amazing transitions that has taken place, and you will notice that even in autocracies today, there is the, at least the pretense of democracy, because people believe that governments that are rooted in people are more legitimate. And that's a battle we won and now have to make real wherever we can. That's point number two. Point number three is simple math. In most places, if you want to get something done, whether it's a smarter climate change policy or healthcare for people or more funding for girls' education, you've got to have a majority of people supporting it. You've got to have votes. You have to have the allocation of resources. And that requires mobilization and a game of addition rather than subtraction. So, and the fourth point I would make would be the internet now has turbocharged the capacity for us to develop movements in ways that we had not imagined before. Now, the last thing I'll say, so that I don't sound like I'm still in the U.S. Senate and filibustering, is, I guess, a smaller point, but a profound one, that I tried to reinforce with my staff at every level of my public work and continue to do to this day. I actually think organizing, mobilizing, starting movements starts with a story. And you can't create a story that moves large numbers of people unless you are able to listen and hear to the story of the person next to you. The story of your neighbors, the stories of your coworkers, the stories of your community. The story of people who are not like you. And so one of the things that I think is important is for us to learn how to listen to each other and learn how it is that we came to be who we are, think the way we do, because that understanding of other people's stories is how you end up ultimately forging bonds and creating the glue that creates movements. Every great movement, if you think about Gandhi in India, it started with his understanding of India's story and his own story and seeing Indians in South Africa discriminated against and recognizing that there were traditions and myths and a power in those stories that ended up driving out the most powerful empire on earth. It wasn't guns. And increasingly that will be the case, and certainly that will be the case if we want to move forward the sustainable development goals that we're talking about, is we've got to be able to tell a story not only to big donors or politicians, but also to, for example, people here in the United States who may feel like, look, I've got my own problems, why should I be worrying about somebody on the other side of the world?
Yeah, I have to say, when we got into philanthropy and particularly studied global health, we were stunned at the progress. We'd had no idea. And it's kind of amazing if you ask even very well-educated people, what's happened with vaccination, what's happened with HIV. They don't know the positive story. And a little bit the news is always going to focus on the setbacks, because that's what happened that day. The gradual progress doesn't fit that paradigm. And even people who raise money for these causes, I have to say, sometimes even some of the material we create is talking about the piece that remains as though it's never improved. Do you have any thoughts on how we get this more positive sense of progress going and what how we would get that word out?
Well, look, you're talking to somebody who for 7 years tried to get the word out that things were going pretty good, and nobody, at least about 40% of the country didn't believe me until I was gone, and then suddenly they believed it, and they said, things are great. So with that caveat, I'd make a couple observations. One, you're right, Bill, there is the nature of the media, and maybe just the human brain, is to fasten on what's wrong, not on what's right. And I'm not sure we're going to be able to change that, right? Visual displays of a fire are much more interesting than just a building sitting there. And so the fire is going to make the news, the building sitting there nicely, and people are walking their dogs in front of it and stuff. That will not make the news. So I don't think that we can count on conventional media necessarily to spread the word. This is, though, where the power of the internet has not, I think, been harnessed the way it needs to be, particularly when we think about young people and young audiences. Malia and Sasha consume information differently than I do. And I think that those of us who've been involved with policy work are still putting out these reports with pie charts and this and that, and that's not interesting to them. But stories and visual representations of progress can go viral. There's a hunger for it. It's just that we don't systematically think about it. And so I think when the three of us were talking a while back, I mentioned that one of the areas that I'm deeply interested in is how do we build a digital platform whereby people can go to find out what's happening that is moving the progress on issues and then activates them. Because I heard somebody, I think maybe Trevor, saying an important point. I'm very interested in how online communities can move offline. How this incredible power to convene through hashtags and tweets and this and that and the other eventually leads to people meeting each other and talking to each other. And I think that we have not fully tapped that as a way of spreading the word about progress that has been made. I also think it is important for us to put some friendly pressure on leaders to tell good stories and to make sure that we don't that we aren't so rigid in our partisanship or ideologies that we are not willing to acknowledge and share when somebody who might be of a different political persuasion has done something really good, even if it runs contrary to our short-term political interests. I always used to say, as big as the differences were between me and my predecessor, George W. Bush, that what his administration initiated with PEPFAR was a singularly important achievement that we needed to sustain and build on. And I didn't think that somehow detracted from me to say that somebody from another political party did something really smart and really good and deserved credit for it. And I feel as if these days, within our political circles, that's a hard thing for people to bring themselves to do.
One of the things that Bill and I had the great privilege of doing when you were in the White House late in your presidency was spending a little bit of casual time on a Saturday night. Mm-hmm. And your daughters were in and out of your home, Malia and Sasha. And you've been to our house earlier this summer and saw Rory and Phoebe, two of our three, in and out of our house. Our daughter Jen is here in the front row. Tell me about...
Jen's like, thanks, Mom.
Yeah, sorry. You weren't home that night.
Jeez.
But she's about the age of
That's
your
our
daughters.
Job, to embarrass you.
Exactly.
That's what we do.
I just did it. Job done right there. But, you know, Jen's about the age of your girls, a little bit older, but how have you and Michelle thought about talking to your children about being leaders in the world and taking up this mantle of what needs to be done in the world?
Well, what we've tried to communicate their entire lives is that each of us has responsibilities. When they were small, the responsibilities were small. Like, say when you want to go potty, and then as you get older, your responsibilities grow. But part of what we, I think, try to communicate is that being responsible is an enormous privilege. That's what marks you as a fully grown human, is that you, that other people rely on you, that you have influence, that you can make your mark, that if you do something well, that that will improve other people's lives, that the kinds of values that we've tried to instill, many of them your basic homespun values like kindness and consideration and empathy and hard work, that those are tools by which you can shape the world around you in a way that feels good. And so what we've tried to encourage is that the sense that it's not somebody else's job, it's your job. And I think that's a ethic that they've embraced. Now, they will choose to participate in different ways because they have different temperaments, different strengths. I think one of the mistakes that we sometimes make is to think that there's just one way of making a difference or being involved. You know, if you are a brilliant engineer, you don't have to make a speech. You can create an app that allows an amplification or the scaling up of something that is really powerful. If you are somebody who likes to care for people, you don't have to go out and lead the protest march. You can mentor some kids or work at a local health clinic that is going to make a difference. So there are a lot of different ways in which to make a contribution, and we try to emphasize that to them as well. And then the third thing that we try to encourage is what I mentioned in my earlier remarks, which is that you have to be persistent. I always tell people that my early work as a community organizer in Chicago taught me an incredible amount, but I didn't set the world on fire. I got some public parks for communities that needed them. I started some after-school programs. We helped set up a job training program for people who had been laid off of work, but those communities weren't suddenly transformed. They still had huge problems. But I took that experience, and then I was able to build on it. And I think so often we get impatient because change does not look as if... sometimes it's not as discernible or immediate or impactful as we had imagined in our minds, and we get disappointed and we get frustrated, and for me, by the way, that's advice in life and not just in social change. I assume occasionally there was a bug in the software build,
every now and then,
every once in a while, you know, and we got to patch it again. This is annoying, but that's how
I heard it a little differently than that.
I wasn't known for my patience.
Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't hear, oh, darn. Bill, did you have one last question?
Yeah. So this week, part of the reason we're all in New York is the United Nations is meeting. And, mm-hmm. you know, so many of these global institutions that were created right after World War II, World Bank, World Health Organization, UNICEF, they've been key partners for many of these causes. And yet, there is definitely a cynicism about their bureaucracy, their efficiency, and their ability to change. In fact, with very few exceptions, like Global Fund and Gavi, we haven't had any new ones. So over the next 10 or 20 years, do you think these global institutions, in terms of reform or creating new ones, for pandemics and climate change, can they step up to play the role we need them to play?
Well, let me first of all say that the biggest problems we confront, no one nation is going to be able to solve on its own. Not even a nation as powerful as the United States of America. There are times during my presidency where I was attacked for not claiming that we could go on our own, as if that was an expression of weakness. No, I believe that the United States is, in fact, an indispensable nation, and that many of the initiatives and much of the progress that we've made could not have been done unless we underwrote those efforts. And I'll use as an example of our handling of Ebola, which in retrospect, I think a lot of historians would argue was one of the, if not the most effective emergency public health intervention in history. We had to create the architecture and the infrastructure and send our military in to create runways where the Chinese could then land planes to deliver goods. And we had to provide guarantees to the Europeans so that if they sent health workers, they could feel some assurance that they could be medevaced out if they got infected. So I take great pride in what the United States can do, but if we're talking about climate change or global migration spurred on by drought or famine or ethnic conflicts, we're not going to be able to solve those things by ourselves. And as you indicated, Bill, if we get an airborne pandemic, unlike a slow-moving, disease that's difficult to transmit like Ebola, if we haven't built ahead of time some structures to deal with this, millions of people could be adversely impacted. So number one, you have to start with the premise and believe that multilateral institutions and efforts are important. And you don't have to cede all your sovereignty, or it doesn't make you less patriotic to believe that. You just have to have some sense and read. So that's point number one. Point number two is that, in fact, there are problems with existing multilateral institutions. Not surprisingly, they were designed post-World War II for the most part, and they couldn't have anticipated everything that's happened. There is bureaucracy and inertia and resistance to reform. So it is important for every country, every leader, to be honest about the need for reform and not simply think narrowly about, well, I want to keep certain numbers of slots or votes or this or that. At least on many of the issues where there shouldn't be a big ideological controversy. Look, reforming the Security Council, that's something that goes to core geopolitical interests and is a huge
difficult and perhaps unachievable goal anytime soon. On the other hand, making sure that the WHO works well and that we have a sufficient security trigger when a pandemic or something else happens, that is achievable. And it shouldn't be controversial. It's just a matter of digging in and getting the work done. When it comes to girls' education, there may be cultural resistance in some places to actually getting it done, but generally speaking, there aren't that many folks who will explicitly say, I'm sorry, we don't want to educate our girls and women. As a practical matter, you may see that in certain countries, but at the level of our multilateral institutions, there should be a broad consensus. And so what I would hope for is that we come up with concrete plans in those areas, oftentimes with respect to the Sustainable Development Goals, are areas where there is a consensus on at least the aims, if not always the means, and think about how can we improve delivery systems, how can we improve their operations on a day-to-day basis. But ultimately, the last point I would make, that requires leaders to feel as if it matters and is important. That in turn requires the public think that it matters and is important, because unfortunately, what you discover is that most politicians and elected leaders are followers and not leaders. They're called leaders, but most of the time they follow. They see what do their constituencies care about, and they respond. And one of the biggest challenges that we've had is that, and I speak most intimately about the United States, the general public responds with enormous generosity when they see a specific story of a child who's hungry, or somebody who's been stricken by a flood. But when it comes to just a general knowledge or interest in development funding, not only do they not know much, but they oftentimes have a negative reaction, because their view is, we've got a lot of needs here at home, why are we sending money overseas? Sadly, it is one of the only areas where Democrats and Republicans agree in the United States is on foreign aid. And repeatedly you've seen public opinion surveys where people wildly overestimate what we spend on foreign aid. They think 25% of the federal budget is going to foreign aid and helping people other than folks in their towns and their communities. So the need for public education in the ways we talked about that tell a good story, that point out that this is actually a bargain, that connect what we do with respect to development to security, not in a perfect correlation, but to say that, look, if you've got failed states, then generally some of that's going to spill over on us. If you have economies that are failing, ironically, if you are concerned about immigration and mass migration, it's really a good investment to make countries work so that people can eat, because then it's not like they're dying to get on a dinghy and float across an ocean. If the place, the country where they were born and they loved, was functioning. So thinking about ways in which we describe this both as an economic imperative, a environmental imperative, a security imperative, the more we can influence public opinion, the more you'll see politicians respond. That doesn't mean that there is not an enormous role to play for NGOs, philanthropy, and so forth. But I've said this to both Bill and Melinda, even with the incredible generosity and enormous skill with which they've deployed their resources over the years, the U.S. budget's still bigger.
Absolutely. A lot bigger.
And,
a lot.
You know, this notion that you can, that I hear sometimes from young people, that you can work around government and work around politics because it's too messy or it's corrupt or it's, you know, I just don't like those folks or what have you. I'm sorry, guys, that's not going to work. If you want to get done what you're talking about, you will have to combine effective philanthropy and technical know-how and you know, smart policy engineering with getting your hands dirty, trying to change public opinion and trying to ensure that the people who are in charge of the levers of power are responsive. And that will require work, and I guarantee you, you will be disappointed at points. What a glorious thing it is to be responsible for saving the world. That's your responsibility. And Arne. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. You're amazing. Amazing.
Am I on? You can hear me. So remember how I said earlier on, well, I never. This is one of those moments. Well, I never. How is it that I am following the President of the United States? I mean, seriously. But before you panic, there is no need to panic, because fortunately for you all, it is lunchtime. Yes, you can cheer. It's okay. You can cheer. And after lunch, things are going to get very interactive around here. So for those of you who are shy, maybe a little Dutch courage over lunch, because it's going to get really intimate around here, and it's going to get very emotional. After lunch, we're going to dive into what lots of you are already doing as goalkeepers and how all of you in this room can become goalkeepers and actually use those goals to achieve your own personal missions. I think you're going to find it really interesting. All right, now, as you head to lunch, a couple of notes for you. Don't forget to look at Sarah Illenberger's amazing data installations. Don't forget Bill's bookstore either. That's all out there. Get your Instagram taken with our 17 Global Goals Cubes. Go and help yourself to the Global Goals M&Ms. I'll be face deep in those if you're looking for me. That's where I'll be. And get badges. Get lots and lots and lots of badges. And don't forget to take everything with you, because we're going to be moving things around. But most importantly, please don't get so excited that you forget to eat. We need you to eat, because this is one of those times where you're going to need your energy, but don't eat so much that you fall asleep when you come back. Because if you've seen Handmaid's Tale, we'll have people with cattle prods to wake you up if you fall asleep. So eat, don't overeat, come back, and we'll get personal. Enjoy lunch.